have a text for criminal justice, criminal Michigan, Scott Ayers, and that as well. Dorian Cotler,
appreciate it. So for my part of this presentation, I'm going to be just giving a basic introduction to the concept of bail, bail bonds, the statutory framework behind bail, and the amount of bail set in Texas, and the context of Texas within other states, a little bit about the practice of bonding here in Texas, and then a little bit specifically at Harris County and how the practices of Harris County are impacting jail populations and other factors. So we'll just start out with the origins of bail. Bail is a concept from English common law, stemming from the presumption of innocence. It's a concept that someone accused of a crime and imprisoned is able to secure their release before their crime occurred by pledging some sort of security. And dating back to the common law, the purpose of bail, the primary purpose, has been to secure the defendant's presence at the trial. In later years, courts and legislatures have made it so that the safety of the community, the safety of the victim, is also a consideration in the count of setting bail. And then finally, just a differentiation between bail and bond, because those terms are often used interchangeably. Bail is the actual security given by the defendant, and bond is the agreement. In Harris County, the bondsman will come to an agreement. So the bond is the agreement between the bondsman and the court. And you can also have personal agreements and stuff like that. So here in Texas, the Texas Constitution guarantees the defendant the right to bond or to bail. All prisoners shall be bailable by sufficient sureties, unless for capital offenses, when proof is evident. So, for those of you familiar with the United States Constitution, the Eighth Amendment prohibits excessive bail, but it does not guarantee that every prisoner is bailable. So Texas is sort of progressive in that respect. There are 10 states that don't include a right to bail in their state constitutions. And Texas does qualify the right to bail that for capital offenses, there is no constitutional right to bail, but that qualification is very limited in the context of all of the United States. Other states that use similar language have added other crimes, treason, kidnapping, other weapons, those are the things. Texas, again, has a pretty wide tolerance for bail amongst other states. In determining the amount of bail, the Code of Criminal Procedure defines how a judge will determine the amount of bail here in Texas. There's 5 rules to consider. It gives the power to the county judge, but then lists the 5 rules that they should consider in determining the amount of bail. So, the first rule, the bail shall be sufficiently high to give reasonable assurance that the undertaking will be complete. That dates back to the common law tradition. They just want you to come to court when it's your turn. The second rule, the power to require bail is not to be used so as to make it an instrument of oppression. That harkens to the language of the United States Constitution that no bail shall be excessive. Now, the third rule, I think, is the most important when you're considering Texas. The fourth rule. The ability to make bail to be regarded and proof may be taken upon this point. This is part of the statute that codifies the need for judges to take on an individual case-by-case basis to determine bail. This says that you have to look at the defendant and his ability to make bail when you're assessing. This is a very liberal provision for a statutory framework, for the statutory framework to determine bail. This is not something that a lot of states have. So again, Texas is more progressive on this bail issue than you would suspect. Now, bail bonds in Texas, there's primarily 3 kinds of bail bonds in Texas. There's the surety bond, and of you in this room, unless you teleported here, are familiar with surety bonds. You've seen all the bail bondsmen outside of the courthouse. Those are the bonds that require the defendant to pay a third party of bondsmen a certain percentage, and the bondsman will come to an agreement with the court to guarantee you will appear your appearance. Personal bond is when you get out with just your signature, no cash, no nothing. The judge recognizes that you realize the seriousness of your charges, you're not going to skip, and you will show up. If you're in this room, you may not be that familiar with personal bonds. Similarly with cash bonds, those are infrequently used, but that's just when the defendant deposits all the bond by himself without going to a surety. And then if he skips out, then it's all given to the court. So now, amongst other states and other countries, the Philippines and the United States are the only two countries that rely on commercial bail bonding for the bulk of their pretrial release system. Though in the United States, a majority of states do retain this system. So a lot of the states in the United States, they look like Texas, though not quite as many bondsmen, but they do rely on the commercial financial bonds. There are states that have regulated commercial financial bonds out, and they have or completely outlawed them. And this, those states have cited the rationale that a lot of the other countries in the world cite, that they're not as comfortable as we are in Texas, or America is as a whole, with the marriage of criminal justice and profit, per se. So in those states, Illinois, Kentucky, and Wisconsin just legislatively banned compensation for being a surety. Oregon, interestingly, banned it as a result of a kidnapping case. A bondsman from California came into Oregon to find a defendant who had skipped bail in California, and he was found guilty of kidnapping, and that eliminated the industry in Oregon. And again, it can be regulated out. D.C. is a very tightly regulated jurisdiction. And the interesting thing to note is that you would think that there may be difficulties in these states that don't have commercial financial bonds in getting people to come back to court, but that is not the case. Kentucky is very successful in ensuring that people come back for their court appearances, and D.C. is just the same. So the numbers don't bear out that you need those sureties to ensure people to come back. So now let's get into Harris County. This is Rule 9 of the Harris County Rules of Criminal Court, and this dictates how bail is set in Harris County. The district attorney shall fix an initial bail amount at the time of complaint of law. The amount shall be determined by either presenting relevant information in the possession of the district attorney to the county criminal court, or the bond schedule. So, if you're wondering how this comports with the Texas statutory framework, you are not alone. It does not make sense necessarily that something could be a generic bond schedule could take into account those five rules, especially the one that deals with an individual's ability to make bail. And again, another thing to note in this rule is that it required the presenting relevant information in the possession of the district attorney. Whatever the district attorney has in their possession, you'll learn later in this presentation about outcomes and how people on bond may or may not be more successful. The district attorney has no incentive to look for this relevant information. The district attorney's incentive will be to secure a higher bond so that their job is easy. So these rules in Harris County, this is just a general overview of the jail population. It's not actually very surprising. Harris County is a lot bigger than other counties, so they do have a large jail population. But if you see, the pretrial population in Harris County would be the largest jail population of any county outside Dallas. And it's almost 36% larger than the overall population in Bexar County. And, you know, while this may not, you know, directly correlate with some of the rules we've talked about, it's something to look at. It's a problem that can be addressed with some solutions. And so here's table showing the pre-trial population since August 2009. I mean, you can see the total population in the jail has steadily decreased from 11,295 in 2009, but the amount of pre-trial detainees has remained steady. So the idea is to look for solutions to bring that pre-trial detainee population down from about 70%. So, and then this graph indicates what we talked about earlier. You see at the bottom is the amount of percentage of defendants released on personal bond, which has decreased from 5% to 4.4% in 2013, all while the defendants out on surety bond has increased to over 40%. And this is a good representation that it's getting more expensive to get out of jail here in Harris County. And that can have a real difficult impact on bringing your case in front of the judge. So, and then finally, I want to conclude with some comparisons between two issues with similar counties in Texas, because just to show that it is being done in Texas, there are reforms that can be done to reduce this pre-trial population. So, in 2010, in Bexar County, 10.2% of the felony bookings received a personal bond. That number in 2010 in Harris County was 1.34. And in the last 3 years, it's gone down to 0.7% of the felony defendants in Harris County. And in Travis County, in 2009, 18,275 defendants of all the people they arrested were given personal bonds. In Harris County, that number was 5,272 in 2009. And as you can see, again, it's getting worse as we go. It's now below 4,000. So this is an area where we can encourage the issuance of personal bonds. It can be a great help to defense attorneys. It can be a great help to reducing the jail population. So then the last thing I wanted to show was El Paso County's bond schedule. So Harris County's bond schedule is very clear. It provides an amount of bail for each felony and misdemeanor offense, and then you have escalators for prior criminal history. El Paso County's bond schedule actually does the reverse. They start with those generic numbers, but then there's many provisions about reducing bond based on age, based on ties to the community, and most importantly, that bail can be reduced by the amount of weakness. This gives the judge great discretion in setting bail rather than requiring them to go off a strict schedule. And so these are the arguments that you'd want to make in front of a judge if you're making them here in Harris County. And for more on that, I will hand it off to Andrew.
Thank you, Mr. heavy human consequences for your client. But, you know, as a defense lawyer, let's leave that aside for a moment and just focus in terms of the legal case. Why, as a defense lawyer, should you care about whether your client is in jail or out of jail, their pre-trial custody status? First of all, having your client out of custody helps you build a relationship with your client. Now, a lot of lawyers don't like having to visit their clients in jail. You have to wait around a lot. I don't know about your skin particularly, but you have to wait a long time. You're talking in situations that are not really confidential. There's other people around. And building that relationship with your client is much easier if your client can come see you in your office. It also helps protect the presumption of innocence. Part of the reason we have the right to bail in Texas is the idea that, you know, these are people who haven't been found guilty of anything yet. And it should take a lot to justify their essentially preventive detention before they've been convicted of an offense. And so part of your role in protecting the presumption of innocence as a criminal defense lawyer extends to protecting their right to remain out of custody until they've been found guilty of a crime. Defendants who are out of custody are able to assist in the preparation of their defense in ways that clients in jail cannot. They can bring you paperwork that might be relevant to their case. They can help you find witnesses who you can be finding on your own, people in the neighborhood that you may not be familiar with, family members who may be able to assist on sentencing issues, to, you know, enlist their cooperation, or employers or other people in the community who might be able to help their case. If they're out, they can play a much more involved role in assisting in the preparation of the defense. They have an opportunity to address the problem that may have landed them, may have gotten them arrested in the first place. So if they have substance abuse issues that are involved in their offense, and you're able to help them get started in treatment before they are convicted and sentenced, so that you can go to a judge and be like, look, this person would be a great candidate for probation. He's already in treatment. He's like, okay, out in the free world. It's easier to make that case for judges. They can see, like, oh, yeah, that is out in the free world. It's functioning okay and getting the help that he needs. And it also, I mean, probably maybe most importantly, removes pretrial detention as a factor in client decisions. When your clients are in jail and they see no way that they are going to get out of jail on bond, they are just never going to get the money to post the bond that's been set in their case, they are often going to make different decisions about, you know, are they going to proceed with that motion to suppress, or do they just want to get out today and take the plea offer, the time served plea that's on the table, or at least see the light at the end of the tunnel instead of waiting 6 months for a trial setting. So being in pretrial detention really increases the pressure on your client to plead, no matter what the facts are that the case are, no matter what defenses they may have. They are sort of at the mercy of the prosecutor because they're not able to secure release through any other way. And a lot of this comes down to the fact that your client's bond status plays a huge role in determining the case outcome. It's hugely important to the outcome of the case. And lawyer, you know, this is something that you're trying to work toward. This is hugely important to you, and I'm going to take you through some data that we have about this. This data comes from the Council of State Government study that was done of the Harris County Public Defender Office a couple of years ago, so it's a little outdated. Mark may have shown this to you before, but I think it sort of bears repeating. There are some pretty clear differences in what happens to defendants who are released on bond. For public defender office clients, if they don't pay a bond, 15% of them have charges dismissed. If they're on bond, almost 30% have their charges dismissed. Deferred adjudication increases from 20% to 31%. Clients who are represented by appointed counsel have sort of similar increases in positive outcomes if they are out on bond. And these populations are pretty similar. They both have over 80% of the client population who are in pretrial detention. So 6% of no bond defendants have their cases dismissed. 16% of their clients have cases dismissed if they're on bond. Deferred adjudication, it goes from 18% no bond to 53% of clients on bond get deferred adjudication. And it also holds true for retained counsel. Again, the clients who have retained counsel and they're on bond have better case outcomes. They get statistically significant increases in dismissals and deferred adjudication. So So that's in Cross County, you know, what it looks like, the difference that bond makes in case outcomes. And that data is not just found in Harris County, it's found in lots of other places. The Texas Indigent Defense Commission had A&N University come in and do a study of the Wichita County Public Defender Office. They were looking really at a different issue. They were trying to compare what was happening between clients represented by the Public Defender's Office there and clients represented by the private bar. But then when they were looking at these outcome differences, they figured out, well, the biggest difference wasn't what kind of lawyer was representing the client. It was the client in custody or not? Clients who were released on bond were 30% more likely to have all the charges against them dismissed. They reserved 54% fewer days in jail if they were convicted. And this study, you know, is controlled for all sorts of variables. You know, it was done by a social science research firm. And so they controlled everything for risk offender level, criminal history. So they eliminated a lot of the other possible explanations for this difference in case outcomes. Nationally, there is a foundation that's actually based here in Houston called the Laura and John Arnold Foundation. They have funded a lot of work nationally trying to increase pretrial release across the country. And their national study shows that individuals detained for the entire pretrial period are 4 times more likely to be sentenced to jail than defendants who obtain pretrial release. And they're 3 times more likely to be sentenced to prison. So, you know, across the board, here in Texas, other counties in Texas, here in Harris County, and nationally, whether your client is in custody or out on bond makes a big difference in their case outcome, which means the bail hearing can be a really important lawyering moment. It might have statistically a bigger impact on the case outcome than maybe anything else that you do as a lawyer in a lot of your cases. So, it's an important lawyering moment, our opportunity anyway. We've seen that what happens at that hearing can have a big difference on case outcomes, but in practice, there are no defense lawyers at bail hearing in Texas. I mean, I have never seen a lawyer at a bail hearing in Texas. It is technically possible. However, for appointed lawyers, there's certainly never a defense lawyer at a bail hearing in Texas because Texas law does not require defense counsel to be appointed until 48 to 72 hours after the bail hearing. So, and this is also a particularly stark distinction in Harris County, where not only are there no defense lawyers, Harris County is somewhat unique in that there are prosecutors at the hearing. So there are no defense lawyers there to make the case for bail, but there is a DA there to make the case for increasing bail from the bail schedule in cases that they consider to be appropriate for bail increases. So you have defendants there by themselves facing a magistrate and facing a prosecutor. In the law, it's not crystal clear at this time whether lawyers have, or defendants have a right to counsel at their bail hearings. There is a case out of Texas that I litigated that dealt with the issue of when the right to counsel attaches. And the U.S. Supreme Court found that the right to counsel attaches at a bail hearing. But in that case, we really were not litigating whether our client had a right to counsel at the bail hearing. Counsel in that case wasn't appointed until 6 months after he had been arrested and magistrated, and we were just saying 6 months was too long. We weren't really focused specifically on whether the failure to have counsel at the bail hearing was a constitutional violation, so the court didn't rule on that issue. Instead, the court just said that you must have counsel appointed within a reasonable time after the right to counsel attaches. So Texas, that's the 15-17 hearing. So you must have counsel within a reasonable time after the 15-17 hearing in light sort of critical stage jurisprudence about what is or is not a critical stage and sort of client is prepared for critical stages. Now, it will come as no surprise to you probably that Texas law is somewhat incoherent on this issue because Texas statute does appear to require consultation with a defense lawyer before the magistrate sets bail at the 15-17 hearing. But because this conflicts with other provisions of the statute that don't require appointment of counsel until days later, courts case law is really going to focus on, you know, in this case we're learning from whether the bail hearing is a critical stage in the case. And traditionally that's been this one case that says it does and one case that says there isn't. Out of the Supreme Court, that dealt with, it came out different ways because of variations in the state criminal procedure that were at issue. There were sort of differences in how those states handled bail hearings. But a lot of the old critical stage case law focused on, well, is this going to affect trial outcomes? Is the defendant going to waive some right at this hearing that's going to affect the trial outcomes? A lot of the critical stage jurisprudence more recently, however, has kind of gone away from that exclusive focus on trial. And with Lafler and Frye, you see a lot more recognition that, you know, those cases aren't going to trial. Plea negotiations are a critical stage. That's why counsel are now held responsible for providing effective assistance in plea negotiations. And I think that that jurisprudence, which is this growing recognition that case outcome in most cases is going to involve a negotiated disposition, and things that are going to affect that negotiation will impact the outcome of the case. I think that those cases create an opportunity to go back and revisit this critical stage argument and make a really compelling argument that bail hearings are a critical stage at which the lawyers should be provided. There is a national movement to increase access to counsel at bail hearings. So Texas is already an outlier in not having counsel at bail hearings. In 1998, 19...